but he's really adapted well.
So we'll see coming into picks and bans. You have to wonder, with that play of Lemonation yesterday, does that spark a thought in CLG? Do we have to ban that? I guess so.
So, it's when it was played, it's been played a lot in Korea. It's also been banned a lot in Korea. So nothing new here. CLG going to take that one off the board. I really liked how Cloud9 handled the Veigar as well. I mean, they comboed it so well with really long-range skill shots, so you don't have to overcommit once you land that stun.
Yeah.
And they utilized the zoning of Veigar's stun really, really well as his ultimate, you know, scaling with the AP of the enemy mid laner. There are ways to play around it. You know, you pick a mid laner with mixed damage, you get some mixed damage in their top lane, but it really puts a lot of work for your opponents.
Yeah, we did see a lot of the bans kind of heating towards the fact of that Veigar pick, so that's something to look at as well.
Yeah, anytime you see Morgana coming out first ban, they're like, all right, there's going to be no Veigar then this time.
Kennen, all the other stuff. And so Nidalee and Annie as well. Go ahead.
Nidalee and Annie. I mean, Annie performs a really similar role to Veigar. Mm-hmm. Very scary roaming around. You could get really long-range picks with those stuns. Veigar's a bit longer range. The only thing is, we haven't seen a lot of supports pick up that Veigar, just because you have to put a lot of time in to get that range down with his stun. It's a bit more difficult to use than Annie's, which is pretty much flash in, point click.
There's no flash event horizons. You don't really see those.
If you get good,
it could happen.
That's the point. When you see them get good, then you get to see those flashes.
The thing is when you place the ring on the champions, you don't just baby cage them in as that instant stun.
Exactly.
Sandra's going to be our last one, along with Cassiopeia, was something that Cloud9 banned out here to start the picks.
So a lot of support bans, also a lot of mid lane bans here. And that's no surprise. Whenever you're facing Cloud9, big question is, what are they going to grab for high? We mentioned yesterday, high's great record on Zed. Yeah. Definitely a very comfortable champion for him.
A lot has also gotten through this game, Kobe. That Rumble, a great champion for balls.
Yeah, for both of these guys. I mean, last time these teams matched up, it was CLG who stole away the Rumble. Mm-hmm. They picked it really early on, and Zion performed very well with it. It was one of the keys to their victory, was stealing away that Rumble. So this time around, Cloud9 not going to let him have it. And they do get balls, one of his most famous champions. That will bring a lot of mid-game team-fighting presence. He's also very comfortable in pretty much all matchups currently of all top laners that are in the meta right now.
That's interesting as well, seeing a Rumble feel comfortable in pretty much any situation, already having a bit of hard time farming, but he does it. He finds a way to get it down. We're looking now at Counter Logic's number one and number two. Obviously, the Riven has been hovered as a favorite of Zion Spartan. We haven't seen that for quite some time. But the Jarvan may just be that lock-in that they're looking for Xmithie in the jungle. Get that out of the way, and locked in right fast. Aphrodite on Thresh. Actually, so, that's going to be the first one for him.
It's a huge playmaking support, which is great for Aphrodite. I mean, he's got a very large champion pool, so a couple of support bans are not that big of a deal. But it is going to allow them a lot more options, and they don't give away anything at all with their first two picks. On red side, they're really counting on the counter picks. So they're waiting for more solo lanes to get locked in here for Cloud9. They want to see what high will go with them. CLG is probably going to save their pick for Link until the very last second. Mm-hmm. Thresh and Jarvan are really well-rounded. Don't give away anything. Might deter high from picking up Xerath, though.
Yeah, that is a possibility. He was LeBlanc in this last matchup. He has the chance to do that again. It'd be nice to dip and dodge out of some scary situations. His idea lately has been to play safe.
It is.
But the Zed play of yesterday, we saw him go back to the split push, back to 1v1ing people when he had the chance. A bit different style, and we may get it again.
Yeah, and back to pulling off some sneaky ninja plays as well.
Mm-hmm. The Corki's locked in as well, which we said yesterday, Kobe, you mentioned once Sneaky gets that, there might be the lane swap for Cloud9 since they like to let him farm safely. And Ahri was left up. A lot of high-priority picks to still go through. It's going to make it a good game.
Yeah, Cloud9 have shown their hand really early in this draft phase. That mid-game for them, they really have to come up with big plays in the mid-game. Corki once he gets his missiles, Rumble once he gets the penetration items. So Cloud9 are going to go pretty hard around the 15 to 20-minute mark in this game.
Looking for Link to lock this one now. 10 seconds. CLG definitely taking their time with these all the way down. Figured the Maokai would be a pickup. More lockdown coming in for Zion Spartan in a safe top lane. and Sivir for Doublelift here. So, like they said, it's not really about the plays for Doublelift to make anymore. It's with the team to make the plays. Yep. That's what that pick is.
Team-oriented AD carry. Exactly the role that they want now from Doublelift. However, we did just see yesterday Sivir endgame six item super carry from Kopp. So
yeah,
if they
that
do
huge.
If they do funnel enough money into him and you get the right items, anybody can carry with a full six item build after selling boots as well. But yeah, that is going to help their engage. I like Maokai with speed boost as well because the range on Twisted Advance, not quite what you want for a hard engage. So the extra speed, always welcome.
Rek'Sai has been something that we see Meteos going back to. Nidalee as well, but we'll see him back on the Rek'Sai trying to get some map pressure.
And I always really like seeing that Rek'Sai when comboed with a team that has a split-pushing threat. Because Rek'Sai, if you have control of the game early, can leave tunnels all over the map.
Yeah.
He can actually support the split pusher. If Hai gets extremely deep with Zed, there's always the threat of where's Rek'Sai going to be, and she can easily add a lot more pressure with that teleport. So really, if they're running the split push Zed plus a teleport top laner plus a Rek'Sai, Cloud9, they have so many tools to pull CLG across the map, and they really are bringing a lot to this mid-game that's going to be fought over the objective trading that both of these teams focus on.
And pulling CLG across the map is what we actually see CLG doing, the roaming of Aphromoo, getting picks and whatnot. We'll see if CLG is the one to be caught in transition.
Yeah, and CLG, they have got tools as well. They've got the Sivir speed boost, right?
That's true.
This game is not going to disappoint. From Champion Select, it looks like there is going to be very strong mind games here.
Very strong. Thinking of just the solo lanes for Cloud9, Balls gets his 12-0 regular season Rumble. Highs on a 12-2 regular season Zed. So the most two powerful picks they could have there better go good for the solo lanes. Obviously, we were thinking about the lane swap, so we'll see if mid lane gets its own kind of one-on-one battle throughout the early part of the game. But this will deliver here. Week 5, Day 2. I'm excited for Game 1. It's going to be
all
good.
Right. Yep, especially with Link locking in that Ahri going to match up versus Zed. This is the ranged nerfed Ahri, which won't really affect her in that one versus one matchup because it's all about landing that charm after Zed uses his ultimate on you.
The crowd is ready. They are loving it. The game about to be explosive. Picks and bans leaving a lot of high priority picks through. Skara and Charlie hugging it out. No, handshake after. That's all right, though. It's just a baggage.
They went for the hug straight off the bat.
Yeah.
So. Handshake clears, unnecessary.
That clears
that
everything
point.
Up. So as we're about to get into the action, start the voting over at LOLesports.com. Tweet hashtag C9win or CLGwin. That's again at LOLesports.com. We'll tally those up throughout the game. You see the picks and bans on your screen, and we are about to go live onto the Rift. It's going to be Cloud9 versus Counter Logic Gaming.
All right, let's see how these early lanes do match up, because Doublelift not only, or Doublelift and Aphromoo have a really strong 2 versus 2 lane phase, but they also have the Sivir into Corki pick, which is quite favorable, being able to spell shield. We shall see how the deep wards work out. One thing that I'm really happy with, the evolution of North American level 1s, since everybody is getting these really deep wards, to see where the lanes are going. People have started counting on those and feeding false information. Meteos doing a little bit of a bait here, feeding false information himself. Just trying to draw CLG in. Maybe they are hoping that CLG will go with a similar rush that they did versus Dignitas and jump into this bush. But if you want to run into a Braum Rumble
nice.
level 1, then you will definitely pay for it.
Yeah, Braum was actually a huge factor in CLG's level 1 yesterday, getting all of those hits on so you can get the concussive blows from Braum's passive. And they don't. CLG doesn't want any of that this time. They know what the effect can be. Doublelift will be one to get a deep ward in. Don't see that that's pinged out. There it is, actually. So Cloud9 does see it, and everybody is aware of the early game information.
Yeah, this is the fun point. Now that both teams have the deep wards, but also know that those deep wards are there. How will they play around it? Looks like Doublelift is just going to hover down bottom. And Smithy with an interesting notion here. Going to start the weak side of Cloud9's jungle to take away right off the bat from Meteos. And this always does signal to me possibilities of going for that early dive. But since Maokai is so far away, I've got to think that Maokai is just going to do his wolf camp and then head up to the top lane to try and soak experience. So really, got to keep your eyes on the Cloud9 duo, since Balls and Meteos are much closer together, if they decide to head up top to try and zone Sion off of the turret.
We'll see how fast he gets back there. We do see that Balls and Zion Spartan have been the better of top laners in that situation. Sometimes we'll see the top laner teleport instantly and then just get dove. These guys, a little different in that mindset. And it looks like they're going to work as a team fully on this one here. The Krug, or rather the Crab, and then that invade.
So Balls, what he did is he tanked up the whole wolf camp by himself doing it, and now every further camp that they do, they're going to have Meteos stand and do most of the camping. Balls will share experience off of the red buff, but he's not going to take any further damage since he did that first camp by himself. There it is. Share the experience.
I like the idea, though. Playing that smart as he put on the scrap shield, he did kind of try and get in for an extra hit. So micromanaging their HP bars nicely, and this is going to be a good clear here on the Raptors. CLG still working on buffs. We have a little bit of rotation here from Afromu to start setting up some wards and maybe early roam.
So both teams with the standard double jungle, but Afromu does get the first roam as far as support's first moves are concerned. It's a deep ward onto the Wraiths.
Yeah. Hai's playing safe. He kind of cut up towards that channel into the mid lane, but no hook was going to be had there.
Yeah, the thing you always want to keep in mind when you're pulling off these lane swaps is give as little information to your opponents as possible. So the supports, whenever possible, hiding in the side lane bushes so that your opponents don't know when you start your roam. Down bottom, COG are taking advantage of the dragon situation. They've cleared both sides of the jungle, and they're trying to pull that off. They should be able to do it. Whereas Cloud9 are just quickly shoving in on the turret. So, a little bit different priorities here. Cloud9 getting a bit of turret damage, bouncing the wave off of the turret to get it to reset and push back into the lane, whereas CLG grab up the first dragon buff, and they will have the exact timer. Cloud9 can guess the timer because they should be constantly checking on CLG members to see if that dragon buff appears, and then they can estimate the timer, because they know that they're giving up control of the bottom side of the map, so gotta keep your eyes out for that.
Gotta get what you can out of it. Cloud9, also that team we know to have very good fighting mechanics and finding the right fights, so maybe they're just biding their time until that comes around.
Now, we want to see the effects, the prolonged effects of the choices that they just made. Because Cloud9 bounced a wave off the turret. There's more, one extra range minion here, and the CLG minion line will be pushing. So Sneaky has the wave shoving towards him, and he can just continue to very carefully last hit so that he doesn't let it go back into Zion's favor, and CLG might have to end up calling up the jungle here. But Zion on Maokai is having a fine time just shoving the wave. He should be able to get it to reach the turret.
Not doing too bad. Hit level 3 as soon as he came in from all that experience and dragon and going for the camps, and an early ward that he placed coming back into lane here. Good pink for Meteos.
Yeah,
clears that out, but
he recognizes the movement there from Zion, giving away that there is a ward.
Playing it safe. This is that privilege point where Zion's thinking, I get every CS I can with staying alive. So far, he's got a small lead on Balls. We do see the Dark Passage go out. That brings Xmithie in. The dodge right through the uprights of Balls and Lemonation, but the hook comes in. He can only dodge so much. That's going to be Balls going down for first blood, and it goes to double lift.
So Xmithie focused the other side of the map. Let's Zion draw Meteos' attention up top, and they take advantage in the bottom lane. They said, you know, not focusing double lift lane is the switch that they've made in strategy. But this time around, they've let Zion do what he does best for this team now. Draw attention to the top lane and allow Doublelift to get a very early lead here on Sivir. First blood equals BF Sword. Now you really got to watch out for that lane swap. Sneaky's definitely going to need his level 6 before he goes to meet that Sivir.
It's very nicely done knowing CLG could react on that after seeing Meteos clearing wards top. Always moving on something when they think they have it. and it's been working for Counter Logic Gaming.
Yeah, and I, again, back to the early picks of Counter Logic Gaming,
yeah.
taking that Thresh. Aphromoo, as we said, he's got such a large champion pool. Anytime you do have that lane swap situation, you could see the effectiveness of flash-assisted ganks for a Thresh lane, taking that Lantern in and allowing Smithy to save his EQ combo.
I think Aphro has six different supports played this season already. Definitely the most. That champion pool really gives teams something to think about. And they still have to ban out some of his champions. Looks like they've got the lanes matched up now. Teleport for Zion Spartan back down to the bottom with a slight level lead over Balls. And a little bit CS down as he just had to go back. So with clearing in the top lane for McSmithy, things look to slow down a bit here as lanes are matched up. We'll see if anything happens in the mid lane.
Yeah, Zion should catch up pretty easily as well since there's a big wave that right. Balls was pushing into the turret. So looking very good for CLG so far. And once again, it is. This season has been a completely different story. It's been CLG on top and Cloud9 looking to them as far as the early game is concerned.
Yep.
Sneaky has been able to go back and get his Sheen at least.
Nice block by Doublelift.
Now he won't have it for the Phosphorus Bomb, though, if they do decide to force another trade. High Lemon, is coming up to
yep.
pinch.
Lemon's far off a six on this one, so this is going to be not a little early, but still something Cloud9 want to get in their favor. With the sweeper pulled out for High already in the mid lane, he's going to be able to clear and head back down. We'll maybe see Meteos come back to the top lane. A minute and 30 on Dragon. Link maybe with his first roam here on the lane push as he wards to make sure nobody's on the follow.
Yeah, so High with the first roam up through the jungle. It was a good call by Link to signal that High just shoved. He's going to be roaming up to top. And that time was wasted for Cloud9. But Link's roam also ineffective.
Yeah.
As a
that was a quick bit of communication
call his
from Cloud9.
Absence as well.
Mm-hmm. Saying mid's missing. Saw the scrap shield back from Balls right away. So he's going to return to lane now with the Sork boots, looking for haunting guys next. That means their next dragon could be a bit more powerful, but within a minute, he may not be able to complete those items. More pressure from McSmithy top lane, so they are actually focusing Doublelift a little bit more.
Mm-hmm. Clearing up the ward there. Going. It also does mean, he's waiting around. He mm-hmm. is level 6. And they just cleared out the ward, so Lemonation going to be the one to check the bush. Doesn't even do it.
That's some patience right there from
so,
Smithy.
If he thinks that Smithy's in that bush, he can just fire a Q towards it. He was in the position to yeah. fire a Q right along the bush so it travels through the whole bush mm-hmm. and would check it. But he doesn't even have to. And Smithy wastes a little bit more time. Meteos has taken advantage of this. He's been hard farming a little bit up. Also been able to create a very nice tunnel network.
CLG basing things nicely off the timing of Dragon. If McSmithy would have hit that gank, it's still theirs, but he backs with that 17 seconds to get in place with the rest of the team for what now should be a Dragon fight, because Cloud9 is also ready for this.
Yeah, the thing is, I don't expect either team to start up this Dragon cold because their dual lanes are up top. And since the first dragon was taken so early, the second dragon still yeah. does a large percentage of damage compared to the strength of champions at yeah. this point in the game. So I don't think they're going to force it. Maybe after we see the lane swap back and teleports are up top. As of right now, though, crab control for Cloud9, so CLG are definitely not going to do it.
Nope. Pretty good aggression here in the top lane. Sneaky and Lemon Nation meeting CLG about 75% to their turret. That hook almost hitting Sneaky. These guys really even out in the lane. 90 to 99 CS. That bit of damage definitely wins the trade for Doublelift. And the hook hitting Sneaky on the side. Aphromoo coming up somehow with that one, just curving it around the minions.
Aphromoo's hook so far, extremely accurate this game. Hitting Balls as well as Sneaky.
Yeah. That's right.
Double of skill shots, nothing to cough at either. We saw the effectiveness of that boomerang blade hitting with a full BF sword behind it. Large chunk, but staying fairly even as far as the duos are concerned. Smithy once again returning to the double lift lane.
Yeah.
Maybe it was a bit of a trick there. When they said in the interview they're not going to focus double lift lanes anymore.
Yeah, the game's
it's still definitely an option for them. They won't do it every game. But when the opportunity presents itself, Smithy's giving away his position, so they probably won't go through with any sort of dive here. Just clearing out the tunnels. Once those things start dropping on the map, they are alerted as to Smithy's position. So
it's also
that
something
gives
they have
Medios some confidence, actually, to work on the other side of the map, since he knows Medios is, Smithy's up there.
It's also something McSmithy has to be worried about, right? You get void rushed when you're trying to do a gank, and Rek'Sai appears immediately. But like you said, Medios taking advantage of seeing McSmithy on the top. He's going to go ahead and get the second dragon of the game. The first one from CLG, actually the quickest one of the split. A bit of info. That's picked up by C9. The gold lead, very, very close from CLG. Only 400 gold ahead.
This is actually what we were expecting with this matchup, right? The fairly close early game.
Yeah, they're just butting heads.
Low kills, and looking much more to outplay once they get to that mid game where they can make decisions based on the movement that they have available. Sivir ultimate is available, teleports both available, and a Rek'Sai ultimate. So both teams with all tools unlocked at this point.
And both teams have been incredibly active with clearing and placing wards. Lemonation dodging out on that flag there. It will not get pulled in, but he also misses the ward.
Yeah, he scared him long enough to back off and so that the sweeper ran out.
Oh,
does cost Medios his raptor buff now.
Like I said, the ward game, pretty active. Just going over a few, almost causing our mid-game fight here.
Yeah, and it's in the ward game, you always have to move up your wards in small increments into the enemy jungle. You can't just dive in all the way to back to the wolf camp. So CLG, this is their first incursion into Cloud9 territory, trying to make a little dent in there and get some wards in. They're able to make that happen. Here's the first rotation. CLG sending their dual lane mid to start knocking down these turrets. Looks like Cloud9 want to answer with the top one. They're leaving Sneaky up there. And it's up to Hai. He's going to have a hard time wave clearing. Rek'Sai and Braum do not help with that.
We'll see if CLG can get Cloud9 where they want them now. Top turret about to go down. Sneaky will have that. But this means
just
that Cloud9 doesn't really have that front row of turrets in the mid lane now. And CLG can start to make their transitional picks if they're in the right spot.
Let's go over the reasons why CLG just made that trade. Because it's just an even one turret for one turret trade, right? However, CLG's turret that they gave up was on the top side of the map. And they got the middle one, which is gives you a lot more area to work with.
Yeah.
So that they can expand that first line of wards that we mentioned on the blue side a bit deeper into Cloud9 territory. Plus, they got away with the red steal. Medios is trying to answer at the current time, though. So all of the objectives are pretty much evenly traded, except that CLG can gain control of mid lane, which gives you a bit more room to work with and get picks for Ahri.
They tried to do that right there, going on to Lemonation and High, but they get out safely. Looks like they will back and CLG realizes that point of the game where they have a little bit of free roam around the map with what they've been doing. So bottom lane goes down as well. Going to be able to set up some more wards. Double lift now at 143 to 33 in CS for that bot lane.
And once again, they have their AD carry down bottom. So they give up mid turret pressure for taking that bottom turret.
It's Cloud9
and now,
doing the same thing now.
Cloud9 are trying to answer. Aframu makes it just in time, though, to scare them off.
Oh, the 2v1 here in the bot lane. Balls, he will be able to teleport back to wherever he goes. And he actually may even live through this one. Gets himself out. Link coming in. I thought he was actually going to be able to dodge that, but Link was able to do one more Spirit Rush and pull it back
into the
angle he wanted. I don't know if they want the turret or more fights here, Kobe. Sneaky's got his focus on that. Cloud9 is definitely calling the audible on this one. They decide to go for the turret.
So while the objectives have been traded evenly, CLG come out ahead because of a little bit of an overextension there from Balls. So in all of the map movements, which we expected there to be a lot of in this game, CLG actually are able to come up with a little bit more of a lead, getting that extra kill. But again, deep ward. Not only is this a blue steal, this is a deep, deep ward.
And this starts to be a lot of denial. That's red buff and blue buff Medios just took. Almost 25 CS ahead of McSmithy. So he's getting pretty big. Hopefully can be a factor for Cloud9 here. They have yet to get a kill, but we've really yet to see the 5-on-5 fight.
Yeah, and we've yet to see High start split pushing as
That's true.
So the strategy here for Cloud9 where they want High to start creating pressure in that side lane hasn't come to fruition either. He's almost done with his Brutalizer. And Bladed of the King, Ruined King plus Brutalizer is really the point where he sits. So he's sitting pretty as far as the assassins go. So We may see them transition high into a side lane once he completes that Brutalizer and swing Sneaky up towards mid.
Right.
But as of right now, still holding his own straight up with Link.
Yeah, doing really good in the mid lane. As we said, Hai has been known to be towards the bottom of the CS list, but he's been keeping even with just about every mid laner here this split, and Link being one of the guys who's near the top. So very well done by both of them in the mid lane to stay consistent. 18 minutes in, we get a bit of a lane swap back. The AD carries and supports are back down towards the bottom lane with Dragon in a minute. That will definitely help for control. But it looks like this turret is now in the eyes of Cloud9. But no roam just yet. We have balls in the top lane, or top side jungler.
Yeah. Very, very sneaky move here from Balls. Cloud9 have been able to sneak some deep wards into both sides of CLG's jungle. So this mid game, Cloud9, very, very diligent in their ward game. Not only do they have three defensive pink wards
in
their bottom
side,
but they have been able to get really deep information gathering wards inside of CLG's jungle.
Jat's favorite pink ward up on the red side, right next to red buff. That one that's hardly ever seen by junglers. It's been there
quite
some time.
Here comes the engage, though. We do have Link's Spirit Rush available. Not going to press
big.
The issue, though.
His Zhonya's is up. Double Lift has Spell Shield, so Hai is going to have to choose the right target going into this fight. He may not get everything he wants out of that first death mark.
Yeah, and the thing is here, these two teams match up really, really well. Not only just the teams, but also the champions they've selected.
Yeah.
The big, big difference here, while Maokai and Rumble are both strong at team fights, the builds differ really heavily at 18 minutes. Maokai has to charge up his Rod of Ages. Rumble's already got the flat penetration ready to roll.
Looks like that Rumble ultimate
going in.
Is out. He's ready to roll it out across the whole team. They're forced to flash, but they are still getting melted by that Equalizer. Zion Spartan's first forced to turn tail now along with Link, and they may even go down as the chase continues. Hai gets himself a little too far ahead for the team to help, but they do pick up the Retribution kill. Link is then forced to flash, and Cloud9 come up very nicely.
Yep, and they should be able to clean up that dragon afterwards. Double Lift does have a decent amount of HP. However, he's really got to be worried about the snares here from Cloud9.
Yeah.
They do still have Braum Q available. All right, he's not even going to go check it. Four members of Cloud9, way too many. And they do come out with the objective after that team fight win. Let's take a look at the effectiveness of Rumble Hard.
Boom.
Ultimate right there. So that's the flat penetration. He was able to zone everybody off, and Meteos gets a magnificent knockup with Rek'Sai on the entire back line. Rumble, definitely a bigger impact than Maokai had in that team fight because Maokai is supposed to be on the front line there, and CLG were sort of split. Their back line was wide open for Meteos to go flash into. And Zion was kind of tied up with balls at that point.
Well, we got our first 5v5 fight. Seem to go in favor of Cloud9, but I still feel like if the pick happens first, it's very much so in favor of CLG. So with that, 1,000 gold lead, rather. Actually, not even. That's a 400 gold lead as we see what CLG is accruing in the hundreds. So very close still in this game. Cloud9 is going to be able to clean up these waves after that fight towards the dragon and picking up their second one 20 minutes in. Baron is now alive, and I wouldn't expect that unless we get a big ace in here at some point. CLG is just going to go ahead and reset their wards after losing that one. Still looking for Aphromoo to get picks on the rotations, but Cloud9 is getting the game they want right now, and they don't have to go into any of those bad positions or scary spots. They're doing everything on their own terms.
Yeah. Good job by Cloud9, you know, taking advantage of that earlier spike of Rumble, forcing that backline all to group up for Meteos. Now, though, without the flash from Meteos, a lot less threat from that Rek'Sai. He's much easier to kite, especially for champions like Ahri, like Sivir, who can also spell shield it. So Cloud9 returning to the spread out game. They still have teleports available for both top laners, and there they go.
Oh, no. Hai gets caught out here. He's going to go down. Zion Spartan teleports in, so top lane's going to get a lot of pressure out of this, and CLG needs to grab something.
Yeah, I mean, that's actually kind of lucky for Cloud9 that they were able to get the teleport cooldown, because Hai was pretty much dead no matter what there. But at least Cloud9 were able to have CLG burn that teleport cooldown. No objective can be taken afterwards, so it won't hurt Cloud9 that much.
Yeah, it looks like CLG is able to recuperate as well. The top turret doesn't really take too much damage. Just gets pushed in by balls. Xsmithie is there to handle it as the rest of the Counter-Logic team try to put some damage on this mid turret. Double lift. A little scary there, but he gets
Here's the answer teleport.
Yep. There's two harpoons onto Aphromoo. He's going to try to fight one side while Meteos takes on Zion and double lift. Looks like they are able to split this one effectively, get inside and slalom out the minions. Looks like the sun was in his eyes on that one.
Constant slow from Braum, so good at chasing people down.
They have the team to slow and keep people where they want them, but the Dark Passage is what you need to get them out, and they have that on the side of CLG.
This is a really good game so far. Both teams with some very strong plays. Hive revives and goes to answer the long lane that Link has shoved up. Mm-hmm. So he should be able to relieve all that pressure on bottom. And basically, both teleports used with strong disengages from the enemy teams. So really all it came down to was that one death sentence landing on high in the enemy jungle. And again, a small chunk of change for CLG to pick up. Such an incredibly close game here. It is going to get down to the wire.
So how do Counter-Logic Gaming approach this fight, right? Because Xsmithie can initiate, that's great, but you're also giving an area for balls to rumble all pretty a lot of the people on that team that want to initiate.
So what CLG are really looking for is they're waiting until Cloud9 try and take advantage of their split push threat with Zed, and then they'd like to use Sivir Ultimate to rush down the other bunch of the team that isn't Zed. So they're looking to rush down the four-man or three-man squad with the Sivir ultimate because they've got Jarvan, they've got Maokai, who can force that engage if they can get in range.
Well, this looks pretty advantageous. If they can get this one, Link coming in here. Great denial of the turret damage so far, but it could be bad.
Okay, so here comes Hai. So that's going to be all five members of Cloud9. And remember, no teleports available for the top laners. If Hai committed to that and he made it all the way up, yeah, CLG would have to burn Sivir Ultimate defensively to back away.
That was a good collapse by Cloud9.
Pressure mid.
Looks like he will be answered by Zion Spartan for now. This turret pressure will cause it to go down. The outer ring now for Cloud9 has been hit up, but CLG can't afford to move that much farther down the lane. Hai is still trying to rotate up, but he may get pinched himself.
Braum is lagging behind a little bit as well, so CLG actually have really good positioning right now.
There's the ult from Sivir.
Sivir pops it to try and snag someone, but they couldn't quite get it, and now they have to abort.
Very interesting. Both teams giving a lot of respect as they approach each other within these fights.
The team fight position is going to be so crucial. Rumble ultimate burned just for a little bit of a slow here.
Oh, plays,
they go all in.
Plays on top of plays. And Cloud9 had enough with just almost coming up with kills. So they secure one there.
Coming
good damage
back.
Onto Xsmithie.
Might re-engage without Aphromoo.
So close on the back line. They're pinging him out. Cloud9 now sees Zion. And it's going to be 14 seconds on Dragon, so a team, they do have an objective after this. If Cloud9 comes up big, it looks like right now they've just gotten control of the top side of the jungle.
Wise call to abort that flank from Zion Spartan.
Yeah.
Because not only had Aphromoo gone down, but also the backline had sustained quite a bit of damage in that trade running away. So once Balls got his second flame spitter off, there was no HP left for CLG to work with. Zion has gotten himself very deep, running away after the flank attempt.
He's playing a scary game of Ring Around the Rosie right now. Dodge it. Oh no, he's going to throw over, so now they know somebody's behind.
He's looking to pop some tunnels as
this
well.
This is good though, because Counter-Logic Gaming has also made themselves apparent in this fight, and they may have just gotten themselves what they wanted here.
Everybody's joined though. Rumble Ultimate still not down. Looks like he's got another 15 seconds or so.
Few to go. This is big. This is where Xsmithie and Zion Spartan can go in and be the Bass Brothers on that front line of the composition. It's all about kind of baiting out this dragon right now as they stare into the whites of each other's eyes.
Watch the team fight position. It's going to be really crucial for this one. This could make or break the mid game. Rumble Ultimate back up. They've bought enough time.
Sneaky very low on mana. May not be able to participate too much from the fight.
Hai is pressuring mid right now. They're just trying to stall this dragon from CLG in order to get a secondary turret.
The pressure, that's Xsmithie, and that's the start of the fight. Zion Spartan's going to get burned up, but so is Meteos. Zion goes down, Meteos goes down, and the fight continues. We see the back line is Link, Zanyan in, and he's able to flash to safety. Xsmithie takes one more shot from Sneaky. Doublelift doing what he can as the solo AD on the back line. Can he get over the wall? He does. He saves himself. The sneaky follow. He gets one. It's going to be Link and Sneaky now back and forth.
You
can see the face of the mountain keeping him safe, but he may not have enough to pursue that kill. Another fight for Cloud9.
Yeah, back to the objective, though. Mid lane here. Hai got a lot of work done while they were taking Dragon.
Yeah.
Let's see if he can actually finish this off. Well, he didn't get that much work done,
but
he's got a long time with it. So he will be able to drop the teleport at least.
All right, so that actually gets saved. I was going to say, we don't see any home guards on CLG, but Zion still with the TP up. Saves a turret.
So I really like the beginning of this, where Cloud9 were getting a lot of turret damage, but they stayed very close here. And actually took the fight 4 versus 5. By the time Hai arrives, CLG have already committed to this, so he's able to clean up. And it's just a question of how many extra kills can Cloud9 get. After this point, they probably should have just taken it. Balls gets a little bit too close, and as we know, Link's able to land the combo on him.
That was big. Lemonation just stood there and said, keep hitting me.
But double. Man, how this is such a close game. Back to that, the decision making there as far as pushing mid and backing off from Dragon and allowing Hai to just trade the mid turret
and get the rumble all
for the
up.
Dragon instead. It's a really interesting choice because CLG had sustained a whole bunch of damage while doing Dragon and getting poked the entire time. So it looked like Cloud9, they sort of wanted to still take the fight, but they didn't call Hai down from mid lane
right
for the beginning of it, not quite in time. So it seemed like some of them wanted to just back off and trade the turret, and some of them actually wanted to take advantage of the fight and the low HP of CLG. Here's another one.
Well, that's the thing we've been looking at as the late game shot calling from Cloud9, and right now it seems to be quite on point. The kill coming in for Aframu there, usually the playmaker for CLG, so they're on the back foot here.
Once again, Balls, the long-range Rumble ultimate, they use this thing not only to win early team fights, not only to win around Dragon, but also to pick people off. He continuously uses it as a long-range slow on enemy carries to get people in range for the rest of Cloud9 to follow up. Really, really great usage of this Rumble, and we would expect nothing less.
Strong control of the game. Very nicely done from the early game to now. Cloud9 has had a bit of a lead, now stretching that to 3K. But the fights are really what came in their favor. They were waiting the early game. Well, CLG, we've been seeing them very strong. But that first fight with Balls present in that Rumble Ultimate changed everything.
And once again, especially when these two teams match up, you constantly have to keep checking back in on the vision control. It's an overwhelming win for Cloud9 right now.
Looks like a light bright.
They have the entire map under their control. And it's CLG trying to fight back and slowly clear out this vision. So Hai has all of the information that he needs to make the choices as far as the lane swaps go and objective trading right now. Plus, they have the teleport advantage, so it makes things a lot easier.
Right. Ball's teleport is up. We'll see if Hai can get back into that flip push mode, back to 1v1ing people. It's definitely been a playstyle change now that we're in, I'd say, that the second half of the spring split that he has turned around. Now with two picks on Zed, so if the team bans that out, he may not have the same results, but showing consistency is what Cloud9 needed from the mid lane.
Yep. Once again, on a very comfortable champion, performing well. They do have to worry, though, because they do have Corki as their AD carry. And he will start to fall off. Right now, he's at pretty much the biggest power spike, Trinity Force and Infinity Edge. Mm-hmm. But as you get later and later into the game, when more resistances are built, he struggles with which type of penetration to build. And you can already see quite a few armor items coming in for CLG.
Yep.
Zion Spartan starting to get tanky. Already got the attack speed slow from Frozen Heart Aura. Smithy's already got his Randuin's, which is one of the jungler's favorite mid-game items.
More of a vision war right now with a minute on Dragon, making sure Baron doesn't go down uncontested. Chronologic Gaming and C9 work the top half of the map here. 31 minutes in. Heck of a lot of action coming out of every lane throughout this game. And really, I wouldn't say there's been any big mistakes to be had. Both teams are getting what they want. Cloud9 more in the fight phase and CLG more in the early game. Now as we approach mid, it is CLG trying to get back, trying to get their footing. Maybe 40 seconds of the Dragon is what does it. That would be number three on the game, but we always kind of see number three as the one almost most given up, and people just don't worry about that because it's not five. Three is not five, Kobe. Go figure.
Good point, Riv.
It's going to get intense, though. 30 seconds on that Dragon, Kobe, and they have not left this middle part of the map.
No, they have not. We'll see how highly CLG value that move speed bonus of the third Dragon. Because once Cloud9 get that, I think that is going to be a fairly big boost to the way they want to finish out this game. Since they have constantly been having the split push threat and then using the long-range Rumble ultimate to catch someone and slow them down, if they do have that extra speed from Dragon, it makes continuing with that style a bit easier. And they don't necessarily want to take a straight up 5-on-5 heads up because Double Lift, Infinity Edge Phantom Dancer, and soon Bloodthirster.
Boom.
Hashtag AoE damage.
Not five.
Three, still not five.
Hashtag three, not five. 2,000 gold now for Cloud9. Working that on basically a few turrets. We talked a little bit about high and balls getting those pretty much their best picks and champions. And the solo lanes have done very well for them, so that went accordingly. And now with the control on the map, they feel like it's good enough to go towards this top side, start putting pressure here until they go for that bottom tier turret once Baron is down. Blue buff goes over to Sneaky so he can keep spitting out some DPS in these fights.
Yeah, so that was actually a fairly interesting series of events because I was expecting once we get towards this point in the game for Meteos to actually start saving his ultimate for cross-map plays. Rather than using it just to get out, either to cover a split push or to rejoin the rest of the team. But he did just use it to get back onto the map quicker, get the blue buff down faster, and there won't be a situation where Hai's kiting backwards and he needs to use it as a cross map.
Whoa! 3,000 gold on Sneaky. Well, it's 2.8, but close enough. He's going to go ahead and completely start chucking items into the inventory. Now the Infinity Edge Triforce and Blade of the Ruin King for him. So once this team starts speeding up and getting on his rear, he can get a little kiting for himself.
Yeah, and that is the time in the game where Cloud9 really need to look towards the end game here and how they're going to finish this one out. With two secondary turrets still left up. Well, it looks like they're actually just going to get hard engaged on here. Zion goes for it.
Very close. Ventral Maelstrom is down. That actually mitigates quite a bit. High gets hit, but the team's not in range. We saw Smithy start to walk in. There was a lot of miscommunication from CLG to start this fight, and they are on the cooker right now. It's going to be, that is Zion Spartan going down. Good back out from Meteos. A lot of damage can still be traded from CLG, and they hold off nicely for that engage from Cloud9.
Ooh, barely escaping that charm. That was actually a fairly disjointed team fight from CLG.
Yeah.
When we pull that one back up, you'll see a lot of uncertainty on the side of CLG as to the engage there, because they back off while Hai is hooked by Aframu. Teleport comes in. All right, well, here's Rek'Sai ultimate back up. Maybe that's why he didn't hesitate to use it. It's such a short cooldown. But he is going to go really hard for this Baron immediately with just Zion down. And Zion has teleport available. Cloud9 should be timing this teleport. This could go very, very poorly for them. CLG can catch them in the pit.
1 second back in. That teleport's going to happen. That turret can't be taken down. Meteos gets the smite. That means Xmithie and Zion Spartan are left alone. The team tries to come in. Double Lift does not have his ultimate, so they're forced to just kind of walk in slowly, but they are delivering the damage necessary. Zion Spartan across the wall, and now a 2v1. The team joins the party, and they shut down Sneaky, and CLG just turns the game on its head.
So they do get two kills for one, but the Baron, Cloud9 still escaping, probably with the advantage there. I mean, CLG can take a turret, but they're still only at secondary turrets. So one secondary turret going down that was already low is a pretty good trade still for this Baron, because Cloud9, with this team, they really need the extra power of Baron to end the game.
Yeah.
So at whatever cost it is, they needed that Baron, and they were willing to take that risk.
Don't do it. Don't do
it. You can tell he knows something is up. Hai's playing with them. They're sitting on the ward. Of course he knows something's up.
He knew. It's just Hai being Hai. He is doing all the fun stuff. 36-34. He had the safety of Lemonation, which was why they kind of tried to pull that fight back in. And now they are rushing for the top side of the map here, it looks like. They're going to be walking through quite a bit of wards, though, so CLG will know.
Yeah, crucial tool here for Cloud9 to get that Baron buff. Really, really empowers that split-pushing threat that they have, because they can get two lines of Baron-empowered minions. Plus, Hai can go for solo kills on your jungler.
It's going to be a... Oh, I was going to say it'll be a little harder with that inner shield turret of the Iron Solari, but he just blew right through that shield.
And there are quite a few wards in this red side jungle from CLG. Hai with another ninja mission. Getting through the early warning system from CLG.
If you take
out a member, then that's going to make the push really easy.
We do see that a few members did make it out of that Baron fight alive from Cloud9, one mainly being Hai, so if they want to get any kind of a split on, they have the minions in that wave. Lemonation very low. Zion walking right towards the front of the fight. Link tries to go in with Spirit Rush. He's going to use the rest of that. Cloud9 feels a little more comfortable to put pressure on the turret with those ultimates being down. And Cloud9 is forcing CLG to walk backwards as they take their base.
Yep, good job working with the Baron buff and the Corki spike. It will be able to get the inhibitor. Uh-oh, here's the re-engage,
The ulti. Meteos gets hit. Cloud9 wants it as well. CLG go for broke in their own base. That's going to be Lemonation going down. A double kill for Link to get him going in the game. He has not seen that much action from the mid lane Ahri this time. And CLG get a few kills, but not a whole lot to get back into the game. They're just able to get those after their inhibitor goes down.
Yep, couple more kills. Are going to start adding up here, but the inhibitor line down is going to be huge for Cloud9. Sneaky, you can see he's not even going for the last whisper for his fourth item. I think Freak would be pretty happy with that. At this point, I don't know. There is a lot of armor on there on their opponent's team, though. But anyways, he is going to go with that bloodthirster for the extra defensive stats.
CLG doing what they can to prevent number four, so number five doesn't become impossible for Cloud9 once they start rolling through the map with it. That is going to be just about 40 minutes on the clock. Dragon goes down, and we'll see Cloud9 trying to dictate a little bit across the map towards mid lane, towards top lane. It might just be this mid lane turret that goes down next. You can see all the vision being put up and the resources being denied here by Meteos. Cloud9 looking a lot stronger. The first time these teams played, it was CLG's win, and they did not want to go 0-2 on the season versus these guys.
Yeah, they are looking to get vengeance here. Mm-hmm. They do currently, you know, have the upper hand. However, they have to be very careful with how they execute. They don't want to give any more money away to CLG. It's still a fairly close game as far as the team fights are concerned. CLG can come back in this with just a little bit of a misstep in that teamfight execution from Cloud9. But so far, Cloud9 have looked much, much more accurate with their skill shots and their engages in the teamfight, and it's definitely paid off. CLG a little bit more disorganized once they get into the teamfights. Right now, though, starting off with a hook onto Lemon under turret.
It's a big Braum right there. This is really the first time we've kind of seen CLG really play from the back foot, not having Afro be the one to initiate a team in transition with engagements. And it seems like they're having a little trouble getting back into this. However, yeah. Cloud9 is also making it difficult for them.
They are. And CLG are really hoping right now for a hook on a bit higher priority target than Braum. If they get a hook or a charm.
Well, double lift on the ultimate front. There's one. Oh, wow, we got three members in that one. Xmithie's going to get hit up big. It is just a cluster of a fight right now. And CLG towards the back line is Zion Spartan peeling off two. Damage coming in from balls here. Meteos taking turret shots. A double kill for Meteos before he goes down, however. And Cloud9 is now fighting underneath the turret without a care in the world. And they have completely pushed off CLG, showing that they have the dominant 5v5 overall.
Yeah, I really thought that CLG were going to wait for one of those skill shots to land.
Right.
Then pop Silver Ultimate. But they actually just rush out of the turret and get counter-engaged by Cloud9. A beautiful, once again, Rumble Ultimate from Balls opens up the counter-engage here. And that should be
there's been so
Cloud9 taken home.
There's so much else to watch in the game, Kobe. We missed a Nexus turret going down because Cloud9 just has minions all over the map right now. They go in easily, take the second inhibitor of the game, and now it's just down the mid lane. If they want to take it, they could easily just go for the Nexus turret here on out. But a great game so far, and a 7,000 gold lead to top it off.
That is exactly what Cloud9 were looking for. Two inhibitors down. Now it becomes much easier to finish it off.
The Cataclysm was great.
So they jump in. Look how far back Link is, though. He has to use Spirit Rush just to get in range. And then not able to land the charm onto Balls there. Actually, Lemon was the one who took it. So Link with the Ahri wasn't able to get that skill shot in between, you know, past this front line onto a higher priority target. Great counter engage there from Cloud9.
C9's focus in these fights is crazy. Doublelift got hit with the Equalizer and was on it the entire time. From two more pop-ups and then a slow, and then slow on the Equalizer, he had no chance.
Yeah, Balls has been layering his Equalizers over
Doublelift
almost every time, and then at least one other person as well.
Sneaky's Equalizers, too.
Sneaky was Valkyrieing forward as well. I like it, especially on a Corki build like this, where you're extremely beefy for an AD carry. Very few other AD carries can afford to build like Corki does and get the sustain of not only Blade of the Ruin King, but also Bloodthirster with the shield and the health from Trinity Force. Corki late game almost kind of turns into a bruiser at the cost, though, you know, of that dedicated armor penetration since his damage is split.
CLG flexing their muscles there, pretty much just to get a Warden. Meteos coming out of base now with a Guardian Angel. He's going to be a nuisance to take down. Big, big items here for Cloud9. Obviously, the same for CLG, but everything is really working in favor of Cloud9 right now with the 5v5.
Yeah, all that they want to do right now is keep CLG interested.
Yep.
A line of super minions will take out a Nexus side turret by itself if it's a side lane that has the inhibitor down. So, CLG, they're making the counter push up mid. If Cloud9 are just going to try and waste their time, then they're at least going to try and push up mid, get an inhibitor for their troubles. Interesting trade going on. Cloud9 are trying to finish the Baron.
Winions.
Nexus under attack.
Winions! They don't even have to be there right now.
Zion has
Zion
to be there.
Zion Carton sprinting back. The Nexus taking quite a bit of damage at half health. Here comes the teleport in. Oh, it's going to be the Void Rush as well, but he's only going to the bottom lane. Either heroes, Balls and Hyde coming in strong. They got the two best solo lane champions, and they're able to take him into the base to end the game. Cloud9 takes down Counter Logic Gaming.
Even at the very end of the game, Hyde able to use Deathmark to dodge the Twisted Advance and get in range of the Nexus. Just really crisp play from Cloud9 all game long.
Very classy stuff. A strong played game. Great back and forth between both teams in the early game. The vision was being placed and cleared equally. The fights were kind of happening in favor of CLG, but Cloud9 made sure they were getting opportunities that led to a very strong mid game. The Rumble ultimate that we saw in the first fight, and then the second fight, and then the third fight were big plays. Big part of the game was to Balls and the rest of the team playing strong.
So, everyone still with that question in the back of their minds. Is Cloud9 really back this season yet? Have they cleaned up their problems? They looked really good this weekend, but they have had one thing that's been constant for both games, and that was high on Zed. That is something that I think next week teams will be targeting. I don't think that teams are gonna let him have it anymore.
So Cloud9 does what they have been needing to do quite throughout the entire split, is now 6-4, is get that win. Staying in the middle of the pack for these guys is not something that they're used to.
Yeah, and High's 13-2 now, I think.
13-2 on
Zed. Normal season game.
13-0 on Rumble for Balls, normal season. So, yeah, if they didn't get the wins on those champions, I would have been very surprised and a little disappointed, not going to lie. Very happy with that win. Meteos doing great things in the jungle as well with the Rek'Sai. Using the tunnel pretty much every time he could to keep pressure on the map. He wasn't waiting for certain fights, using him to make sure he was out there being present, omnipresent for that matter, and really getting things down. A few times we saw the roams from CLG not working because Cloud9 was the team in place this time. Usually we see the roams being CLG's forte.
I mean, Cloud9, they grabbed vision control pretty early on. Really deep into CLG's jungle. I mean, it was really quick, too. It wasn't like a slow process where they worked their way up with the vision.
Right.
They just went on some really deep excursions through CLG's jungle, laid it down, and they never let CLG clear it back out.
So